Let's discuss something interesting. That is how, as an adult cardiologist, I improved myself. My wife being a cardiologist, that was a kind of an obligation, and she does a very large volume of OBGYN work, and it was kind of a requirement that I do a fetal echo, because being a cardiologist, she also thought I know lots about fetal heart. I also thought I knew lots, but the game changer was somewhere in 2010, where I ended the meeting of International Society of Ultrasound and OBGYN. This was the World Congress, and that happened in Prague, and orchestrated by the senior radiologist and obstetrician across the world, those who were delivering talks on fetal echo. And this is Dr. Ravi Choi, is one of the very senior, and has written a book on fetal echo. That's for people, those who are doing an echo, not fetal echo. Those who are into fetal cardiology, they know all about it. And so attending this was a kind of an eye-opener. What did they say there? They told us that use indirect signs for diagnosis of various cardiac disorders. For example, they said, forget about looking at pulmonary veins, you know, forming and a vertical vein and going there. Look at the distance between aorta and LA. What? Then they said, okay, for a diagnosis of transposition of great arteries, you can pick up the diagnosis if you see a single vessel in a three vessel view. Then for a coarctation, you look for RA and RV dilatation. And obviously for arrhythmia, you don't have any clue because you don't get an ECG. So I was literally wondering, because whenever God sends you on the earth, probably tells you, whispers in your ears, yeah, you are the best, and rest of the world is okay. So I thought, no, I am a cardiologist. I could, why make a diagnosis indirect signs? You can see the pulmonary artery arising from the LV. Where is the big deal? And you can whether entering into LA or not. Why should we? And we can see a coarc segment. We see it so often in a suprasternal view and take a Doppler. So that was my initial impression. But when I heard through the talks, a lot of things get clarified. That probably was my view. I hope it is not your view as well. I thought I could, the waters are shallow. And even if I do not know fetal hemodynamics and medicine, I would be able to do fetal echo. So even if I don't know how to swim, I would be okay. From there on, it took me about a decade to a journey from learning fetal echo, the passion every day, and to reach a level that, you are a kind of a faculty in majority of the fetal cardiology conferences across. So now the major issue, if you may think, is the size. Size does matter. And I've just for a comparison, I've kept an almond around with the fetal heart, and that's a fetal heart we autopsied. And this was about 19 weeks gestation. And this is the size of the fetal heart, and that's the size of an adult heart. Okay, so size is something which was very, very critical in making an assessment. So what it was challenging to the equipment currently. The equipment has improved remarkably over past, but I'm talking about 10 years back when I started my career. You needed to had a very high temporal resolution, because the heart moved at a speed of 140, 150. The average rate is 110 to 160. That's normal fetal heart. So it moved very fast. So you needed an equipment which could capture a very fast moving object. You needed a very high spatial resolution because the structure was too small. The structures, you need to differentiate millimeter from each structure, okay? And you had to keep the noise ratio appropriate. So that was a great challenge on the equipments and on us to actually. Now, then I started working hard. I did the ARDMS, which is a this time today, I'm extremely sorry. You can get your coffee, tea mugs with you, because I'm going to take a very slow and a gradual and a good time to share my 10 years experience in fetal heart. And I would wish that I take long time to explain everything which I learned in the past. Now, we went on to optimizing the image. So it may not matter so much in an adult cardiology, but it does matter a lot when you are trying to see a very small structure image optimization would improve the resolution by more than 50%. So reduce the depth, reduce the width, and use only one focal zone. For example, the frame rate from this lousy image where we didn't bother about the depth and other things, to an image where we reduced the depth, we reduced the width, improved at least 3 times. And the resolution you can yourself see is improved. We have way to say the improvement in what do we see, but I think I could say this is twice or thrice better than what I could see otherwise. So the focus now, if you were looking at a small structure, is to optimize. There's a chapter in itself, talk in itself, maybe in case time permits, I would do it some other session. But there are a couple of things which I want to tell you, which you should look at carefully. There is something called balance. These are few things which many of you may not be aware of. There's something called balance in your equipment or priority. That's what in Philips. What does priority and balance mean? Priority and balance means that you have a color display here and you have a 2D scale here. And what priority you want to give to 2D? If you give priority to 2D on this scale, okay, what would happen is that the 2D data would override on the color data. And if you give priority to color, so the color data would be, because both the data are superimposed on each other when you are looking at it. This is just the data, right? So if you more importance to color data, it would be far better in fetal echo, because you are interested in color more than in 2D. Giving you an example here. Now look at this left-sided panel. Now this is the priority given to the 2D. The 2D is given priority. You don't see any vessel in the pulmonary area. You don't see pulmonary veins, and the signals are also not too good. And moment you reduce the priority of 2D, reduce the balance on 2D here, and then you start seeing pulmonary artery in red and pulmonary vein in blue, and that's what. Then reduce the balance. So another example, that if you keep the balance here, then you can see a VST, because a VST majority of time in fetal echo is seen by color, and you do not see it on 2D. And in case you don't do it, then it's very difficult to appreciate this VST in case you've given a priority to two dimension. So that's really important. Now, another aspect which I think, again, you should know once you're trying to improve the resolution of an equipment, is that there are three kinds of resolutions. Axial resolution, that is on the line with an ultrasound beam. A lateral resolution, that is on the sides. And azimuthal is the depth resolution. Now, axial is the best. So whatever structure you want to see, you try to put them in line with the 2D ultrasound. And for color, it's absolutely different. Let's say I give you an example. You want to see a VSD, and you have kept the heart in a apical 4-chamber where the septum is absolutely perpendicular, absolutely parallel with the beam. if it's parallel with the beam, it's vertical. Now this time you would see best 2D, but the color, in case there is a VSD, would be perpendicular to your beam, so the color would not be good. So we advise to keep the ventricle septum at a 45 degree angle so that you get most. I would have never heard of all these things in adult cardiology because I didn't need that much of a resolution because the size was fairly adequate. My color Doppler, even a regular equipment, would show something, a VSD and MR. That was not a big deal. But that doesn't happen in fetal heart. Azimuthal resolution is the worst. That is thickness resolution. Let me explain you what I want to tell you there. Now, this is what you get on the screen. You think that this is a razor thin image, but actually there is a overlap of two images, one from front and one from behind. And this is like a thick slice CT. The image is quite thick. Okay, so low CT, let's say four slice CT, you see structures behind and front superimposed on each other. So what do we see? That you see the aorta and pulmonary artery flows superimposed in each other. So once they superimpose on each other, it becomes very difficult to say. You think that, okay, this could be a truncus. Why pulmonary artery is entering into aorta? What is happening? Nothing is happening. It's just the azimuthal resolution, which is poor. And both these dots, the one is in the front blue one, the green one at the back, represented on the monitor as superimposed on each other. So that is the very big problem why we cannot use direct signs. Because you get so much of overlaps of color behind and in the front because of such a small structure of fetus heart, then you need indirect signs. So that is what lesson one. I learned that use indirect sign because direct signs have frequencies of markedly low sensitivity. To give you an example, that is a VSD. And you can see a VSD where an arrow has been portrayed. And the problem here is the membranous portion of the septum is so thin, it can actually drop out. It can falsely look as a VSD. Perimembranous VSD pickup rate on even a large VSD, the pickup rate is not more than 80%. There is a sensitivity of 80% and a specificity also is low because many times the dropouts can look like a VSD. For example, this is a dropout. You see the arrow, there is a dropout here. You can think that this is a very large VSD, but notice carefully that this is the aortic valve. So you can't have a VSD above the aortic valve, right? So this was the sinus which actually the image dropped out. So because of the dropout, you think that there is some punch there, there is some VSD there. So that is what I wanted to tell you. If you depend upon direct signs, you would have a bit of a problem. So let's say this is a patient where it looked like there are two VSDs, one in the muscular portion on a 2D, where I have depicted by arrows. But if you put the color, there is no flow across those VSTs. So that means they are pure simple dropouts. So, but on the lower panel, if you see there's another patient where there is a large VST and you can see the flow growing inside and out of that area. Again, the angle of insulation is very, very important. So many a times you miss very, very critically important structures. The reason that you did not wait the time till the apex comes to a proper position. So that is a patient, the same patient I'm showing on the right side also. This is the patient, you can see the right atrium and right ventricle slightly dilated. But apart from that, you don't see anything great. But the moment the fetus turns the position, the left and right sides are actually reversed. But now the apex, this is apical four-chamber view. This one, the previous one was the lateral four-chamber view. And apical four-chamber view, you can very clearly see a common AV canal defect. Now, looking at a common AV canal defect has changed your management right throughout. You know, this patient becomes very, very important from a karyotyping point of view, because there's a high likelihood of Down syndrome here. Okay, so just an angle of insonation is very important. That reminds me of a couple of pics what we used to see when we were children. And this obviously to you and to me also looks like a horse, doesn't it? Yeah, that's the mouth and eyes and the ears, and you know, that's what it is. But in case you change the angle of your visualization, and this becomes a frog with the mouth and eyes and okay. So that was just besides point. So now the lesson one is indirect signs. Let us focus on their indirect signs. We adult cardiologists are not aware of what indirect signs are. So I'm going to tell you a couple of indirect signs which I learned in the past, and that's had been very, very helpful. The very first thing which I'm going to tell you is diagnosis of total anomalous pulmonary venous drainage. So these are the pulmonary veins which are entering into the left atrium, okay? And these are the pulmonary veins which are entering into the heart. This is the normal. But if I may tell you that if there had been a small ridge here, and you see the pulmonary veins would form a confluence in this, this is typical of TAPVC, I would show the case. Now, if there is a single line here, now from a normal, it becomes TAPVC. Again, a line dividing, the flow continues to come like this. It appears that if it's opening into LA, but there's just some small, the roof of the left atrium is there, separating that from a posterior chamber, the diagnosis of TAPVC. Just a single line makes a difference between a normal and a TAPVC. Okay, so you can't rely upon just some one single structure to make a differentiate between a normal and abnormal hearts. So that's why till 2002 there were plenty of reports of TAPVC, and the pickup rate was not 2%. We missed large majority of TAPVC fetal ultrasound, which was picked up after and a neonate was born. That is a vein, and this you think that is possibly entering into LA, but you look at this small structure. This is a superior wall of left atrium, which actually is making the distinction between left atrium. This is a partition between that and the posterior chamber. That is the actually embryological defect which is producing TAPVC. So now we need indirect signs. I hope you understand why indirect sign. What are the indirect sign for signs or sign for TAPVC? There are many, but there is one few basics. One is that the distance between aorta and left atrial posterior wall is increased. So that means there's something wrong. This has been increased because pulmonary veins anchor the heart posteriorly. Otherwise, it's hanging free in the pericardium. So now this increases the distance. Probably the addition of a posterior chamber also increases the distance from aorta. So if you can place another aorta between aorta and LA wall, you start suspecting TAPVC. A twig sign, you see something like this, a twig behind the left atrium, you start suspecting TAPVC. Figures are fine, cartoons are fine, but let me show you examples. Okay, that's an example of a patient. The black arrow shows the posterior chamber. You can clearly note that there is an aorta. This is LA, and you can place another aorta here. The distance has increased. The pulmonary vein punctures the left atrium from four sides, different sides, and does not give us a rounded shape like right atrium has. The left atrial shape is not rounded. It is straight here. Something like a box. Now, if the rounding happens, which we called the balding of left atrial wall, again gives you suspicion of a TAPVC. So at wherever the blood drains of the TAPVC through the vertical vein, you can have a dilated coronary sinus because of opening of the pulmonary veins there in the intracardiac one. You can have increased flow in a brachiocephalic vein, and you can have a turbulence in one of the hepatic veins in an infracardiac. So these are again indirect signs of TAPVC. We did publish one presented in Vienna that was Coumadin ridge. You know, Coumadin ridge was first coined when where the people did a transesophageal echo and they found like a blob like a structure, and they thought it's a thrombus and gave Coumadin by mistake. And it was not a thrombus, it was a ridge which was there in the left upper appendage. So this ridge, we said that, okay, we scanned about 3,600 patients, and we presented the data that if we say that if we have a Coumadin ridge present, which means one pulmonary vein is entering into the atrium. So if pulmonary vein is entering into the left atrium, one pulmonary vein, it rules out the diagnosis of TAPVC. At least one is opening. So Coumadin ridge, because it's open, and we could pick up Coumadin ridge in about a 6.2 average minutes when we're doing a fetal echo, so which was pretty good. So Coumadin ridge could be used as a tool to diagnose. So next is a transposition of great arteries where you have indirect signs. Now, direct signs we all know. If I am doing an adult or a neonatal echo, I know you have a saucer and a circle. This thing, you have a pulmonary artery going from the left of the aorta, and this is circle, this is not circle. And if you see both the circles and aorta, aortic valve is right in the anterior to the pulmonary artery, then left to the pulmonary artery, this is a sign of a detransposition of great arteries. And you have an LV, you have a pulmonary artery coming from there, which goes a little more posteriorly than the aorta would, and suddenly bifurcate into two. And that's how you and me would diagnose a TAPVC in an adult or a neonate. If we had the same idea in the past, and that was the pickup rate of TAPVC, till we said, okay, let's look at the indirect signs. The pickup rate by 2015 has improved drastically, but now I think pickup rate is close to 90% with the current understanding of indirect signs. Now, what are the indirect signs? One indirect sign which we use is crossover. You know, normally the pulmonary artery and the aorta, they cross at about 90 degree angle. You can see the aortic flow in the red on the right side, and you can see the pulmonary artery in blue. Okay, so now they are crossing each other. This is a sweep from cranial, caudal to cranial, and you see the aorta red color and pulmonary blue color, they cross each other. So this, if there is a crossing, the TAPV, the TGA is ruled out, because they don't cross. The vessels don't cross. Now, one vessel goes anteriorly, the other vessel goes posteriorly. Okay, this is how the TGA is. This is aorta, this is pulmonary artery, and you see both vessels actually are parallel. So parallel vessels, this is the large VST, and you see the parallel vessels on the right side, this is one vessel, another vessel. You see the parallel vessel instead of the crossover. That is a TGA. Guys, I'm literally halfway. I'm going to take more time. You can brew your tea or coffee in the meantime, I hope. We devised special views to look at the indirect signs. Now we understand that if we have a four-chamber view and this view, three-vessel trachea view, we can probably diagnose or suspect more than 90% of the cardiac disorders. What is a three-vessel view? Three-vessel view is, I will show the three-vessel view ahead, how to acquire it. Now, three-vessel view is a view little superior to the right ventricle outflow view. where the aorta and the pulmonary artery and ductus are included in that section, and it includes superior vena cava and it includes trachea. That is how it looks like. That's the thymus. That's the pulmonary artery. This
Jeevan?
Is aorta. This is and this is superior vena cava. So you see both the vessels.
जो वो अंग्रेज कागज देके गया था दीदी के वो कहाँ रखे?
Can we mute the mics, please? Okay. Then this is how the pulmonary artery and aorta, SVC and trachea. Okay. So in the we did three, and what was the indirect sign there? So that's the two vessels, parallel vessels. One vessel went posterior, one vessel went anterior, and then bent down posteriorly. The front one is aorta, the posterior one is pulmonary artery. And here, if we put one cursor here, that is a three vessel view. Otherwise, we were supposedly looking, we should have been looking at two vessels. But if we put cursor here, so in both times, we see just single vessel rather than two vessels, what we saw in a two. Three vessel view. Third vessel is SVC. So SVC is always there. Now this UV, if you see a single large vessel apart from SVC, that is you see two vessels, one SVC and one single vessel, the diagnosis of TGA is suspected. So there are plenty of advantages of three vessel view. The relative size of the arteries, you can see whether pulmonary artery is smaller, aorta is smaller, because otherwise seeing one artery and then another artery becomes very difficult. Head-on comparison of their flow directions and flow velocities, head-on comparison, and then you can see the aortic arch abnormality, right-sided aortic arch. I'll show you those. You can see another thing, anomalous subclavian artery of the thymus is again important. I would show you persistent left superior vena cava is important, because if you see the persistent left superior vena cava, there is suggestion that it isn't associated with the coarctation of aorta. Whether it's leads to that or just simple association, we don't know. So combining this, we would be able to pick up a lot of abnormality. So now, guys, the three vessel view, those who are not doing fetal echo and adult echo, three vessel view is another very, very important thing. I'm going to tell you how to acquire it. Four chamber view, you slide the probe up cranially, you get an LVOT flow view. You slide it still more cranial, you get an RVOT view. And you slide it more and you rotate the probe slightly to the left, and then you get a three vessel trachea view, 3VT. That is three vessel trachea view. So three vessel trachea view looks like this again, which I am showing you. Trachea is important because we don't need to know whether aorta is going from the left side of the trachea or the right side of the trachea. All right. How can we make a judgment on there? For example, if you have a small aorta, large pulmonary artery and flow is anterograde, the very high likelihood that this is a coarctation of aorta, you small aorta. If you have a small aorta, but there is a retrograde flow in the aorta, which indicates that there is some obstruction here, that means it is either critical aortic stenosis or there is hypoplastic left syndrome. So this is an example of reversal of flow. You see the blue color flow, both should be of the same color, and the red color flow in the aorta, blue in the pulmonary artery. That means the aortic flow is retrograde, and then you see there is hypoplastic left heart. This is the right atrium and left atrium, left ventricle, which is hypoplastic, and the right ventricle. So that was the reason of reversal of. So again, in case you can have a right-sided aortic arch or a double aortic arch, that is decided by the position of trachea. Then this is the right-sided aortic arch. That's the trachea in the middle. So that is superior vena cava. This is the aorta, which should have been on this side of the trachea. It is on the right side of the aorta. And trachea comes in the middle. Okay. So that is right-sided aortic arch. another patient with cardiac aortic arthritis is in the middle. Now, importance of right-sided aortic arch. Now, we can have the most important is if they are benign, but the problem happens that there is a genetic association. They are very commonly associated with that. This is DiGeorge syndrome. You just see right-sided aortic arch. And it is benign. It's not going to create any problem to the fetus, neonate, or an adult, unless it's associated with something else. But pure, simple, isolated right-sided aortic arch, but you need to suspect microdeletion. Okay, there are two ways of proving, disproving. One is you do genetic testing, and second is look at the thymus. If thymus small, it supports your diagnosis. Another important thing in a three-vessel view is what we call as ARSA. Is a anomalous region of left subclavian artery, which comes directly from the aorta after the, it should be the left, it's the right subclavian artery. The origin is after the left subclavian artery. And then after it originates from the aorta, from the, after the left subclavian artery, the right subclavian artery crosses behind the trachea, esophagus goes to the right side. And this is what happens if you see. This is the anomalous origin of right subclavian artery from the aorta, which is called ARSA. And this can, it is benign, this can produce this dysphagia lissoria, but they're very, very uncommon. But the only important thing is that this has a association with Down syndrome. Once you see this, you need to do further testing to rule out Down syndrome. There are other special views. Not so special because we've been using abdominal view, but abdominal view in the fetus is slightly different. Different in the sense that you have an umbilical vein, you have a IVC where the ductus venosus will connect, you have a stomach which is very clearly seen, unlike in the adult, you have a liver which is very commonly seen. Liver generally occupies the entire space, 80%. So it becomes very difficult to say the liver is central, liver is on the left side, liver is on the right side. So we use liver as a sign of isomerism in a fetal heart. So then what do we do? This is something very important, a trick that how to assess the situs. This is less than a minute assessment. What do you do is that you look at number one, that is the spine, you look at the aorta, and you look at the stomach. And you see they are clockwise, like in this position, they are clockwise. If these are clockwise, and once you move the probe caudally, you see the heart and head. That means the head is on the caudal side. If it is caudal, that means you are dealing with situs solitus. If it is not, then the stomach is not on the left side. So this stomach is on the left side if you see the clockwise rule. Anti-clockwise rule, if the spine, aorta, umbilical vein, and stomach are in anti-clockwise position and head is cranial, you are happy the stomach is on the left side. If it is head is caudal, that means this is situs inversus, and what you see here on this side, the stomach, this is the right side. So this is something which you can actually decide. Clockwise, head should be caudal. Anti-clockwise, head should be cranial. And if the answer is yes, you are happy, stomach on the left side. Answer is no, then the stomach, what side the stomach is actually right side of the. So this is how you actually make a diagnosis of situs inversus totalis or a mirror image dextrocardia. The diagnosis of right isomerism is based on juxtaposition of both the vessels. If the vessel, one vessel is the aorta, normally should be on the left side like this. If the aorta is on the left side, the IVC is on the right side normally. If both the vessels are on the same side, stomach may be anywhere in the midline, right side, left side. And this makes a diagnosis of right isomerism. The left isomerism is diagnosed by there is an interruption of IVC because the IVC is a right-sided structure. All right-sided structures, because you are having duplication of the left side, all right-sided structures would get into problem. So the right-sided IVC would get interrupted, and it is continuation of azygous vein, which is right on the side of the aorta, is dilated and sits on the side. So the vein on the side of aorta is the left isomerism. Vein in the front of the aorta on the same side is right isomerism. If you miss this clue, you probably would miss a lot of things.
Wow, beta.
Now, the next step is, do we get gradients? We don't get gradients, actually. Why we don't get gradients? Because blood follows the path of low resistance. I give you an example. For example, there is a double outlet right ventricle. The aorta and pulmonary artery are arising from right ventricle. Okay. And now, if there is a pulmonary stenosis, the blood would preferentially go to aorta, because from aorta, it would go to the ductus, and from ductus, it can supply pulmonary artery. There's no problem. The pulmonary pressures are not high, so you don't get gradients. You don't get gradient between the RV and the pulmonary artery. So you don't get gradient, and you don't get high velocity signals. So if you are basing your diagnosis of coarctation of aorta, pulmonary stenosis, aortic stenosis on gradients and high velocity signals, you probably would miss more than 60-70% of the patients. So forget about gradients. Let's understand a bit of hemodynamics. Now, 40% of the blood umbilical vein goes to through the ductus venosus here, okay, goes to the left heart, because by fossa vallis, by Eustachian valve, and the direction of this jet, it directly enters into the left atrium, bypassing the right atrium. This is just pure simple flow dynamics. So LV and RV systolic pressures are not very high. They are 30 to 40. So in case you are looking at MR or TR, the gradients are going to be accordingly. Now, 80% of the blood from the aorta, from the pulmonary artery, is shunted back into the descending aorta because the lungs are not open. Okay, in humans, the blood into the lungs is less than 20%. Now, here is an important aspect. Now, you imagine the blood flow to the lungs is about 12 to 14%. And what would be the blood flow in the pulmonary vein? It would be low. It will be very low. So that's why the pulmonary veins are not seen very clearly. Reason being, the pulmonary flow is too low. It's just less than 20% of the cardiac output. So now, an example of tetralogy of Fallot's, very easy to recognize. The left side, left ventricle, right ventricle, and ERG, aorta, aortic valve. This is an overriding of this thing because of the mild line septum, and this is a large VSD, which is override by the aorta. But you see the pulmonary artery is small. Okay, and you're trying to look at the gradients, hardly any, 100 millimeter or 100 centimeter per second, or 1 meter, less than 1 meter velocity in the pulmonary artery. So that means the gradient is not too huge. The diagnosis of pulmonary stenosis on tetralogy of Fallot is made by size of the pulmonary artery and not the gradient. Now, I give you a very interesting example. This was a previous child which is born with Gaucher's disease in type 3, and both parents were, and this time the fetus were tested by chorionic villus sampling and didn't find the same mutation. Even the beta glycoside levels were normal. And what did we see? We saw, you know, this is the left side, this is the right side, fossa vallis bulging toward the right. Normally, fossa vallis bulges to the left side. Reason being, the blood mainly comes from the ductus venosus into the right atrium, and from there it goes into the left atrium. pulmonary veins only contribute 12 to 20% of the cardiac output. So rest of 80% blood which is coming to the left heart is coming through the ductus venosus and to the left atrium, through the right atrium, enter the right atrium and then into the left atrium. So fossa has no business to bulge on the right side. So if it is bulging on the right side, you have some obstructive stuff either on the mitral valve or the aortic valve or a coarctation of aorta or something is wrong. But the valves are looking okay. So now, this bulge actually gives you the clue. Fine. Now what did we do? We did a color Doppler. This is a power Doppler. And this is a color Doppler. What you see? You see the flow in the looking okay, both in LV and RV. But if you reduce the Nyquist limit, look at, you see, start seeing some aliasing in the LV inflow signals. So my God, this was a mitral stenosis. That is LV inflow signals still less than a meter per second. But on the right side, the flows were 40 centimeter per second. So this was a patient who had a mitral stenosis, and I reviewed the literature. It's known in Gaucher's disease. Now, diagnosis of coarctation of aorta is a narrow coarct segment here. Okay. And you see a lot of aliasing, turbulence of the flow in the post-coarct segment. And you see systolic, diastolic velocities, high velocities reaching about 4 meter, 5 meter, depending upon the severity and the gradient. So this is a very clear, good diagnosis of coarctation of aorta. But that doesn't happen in the fetus. To tell you, it is fourth or fifth common congenital heart problem. It's the most commonly missed congenital heart problem, to tell you the truth. Isthmus, and anyway, you know, if you depend upon the size of the isthmus narrowing, if you want to see, like you see in coarctation in adult or a neonate, you would say, okay, let us have a look at the coarct segment. If it narrow, it's coarctation. Doesn't happen that way because it is the narrowest portion anyway in the fetal arch. The narrowest portion in the fetal arch is isthmus in a normal fetus. The gradient does not happen. It's a watershed area. The pulmonary artery goes from ductus arteriosus to descending aorta. Okay. And aorta goes to the circulation, cerebral circulation and arms from here. So there's no blood actually flows in this area anyway in coarctation of aorta. So if the blood flow in this area is reduced remarkably, you won't see the gradients. So then what? Indirect signs. That's what I learned in a decade's time, that the commonest sign of coarctation of aorta is RARV dilatation. That's it. Why does it happen? Now, the blood which was supposed to come from aorta to descending aorta, arch of aorta, does not come. Now there is a restriction of, now there is a ductus which is getting the blood from the pulmonary artery to the descending aorta. Okay, the load increases. The coarctation segment also puts load on the pulmonary artery rather than aorta, and the blood in the foramen avail starts flowing to the, preferentially more to the right side. So the RARV dilate both because of increased preload and increased afterload. So that is an example of very severe coarctation of aorta. You see the RARV dilated, and occasionally you can be really lucky to see a coarct segment, but that doesn't happen very frequently. This happens in less than 20% of the patients. You see the aorta, you see the nice coarctation segment. These are the three vessels which you see. This is the left subclavian, the juxta subclavian or juxtaductal coarctation of aorta in this fetus. Another important aspect is ventricular dependence. Now, in the fetus, in adult life or neonate, you have lungs which are aerated with lungs. Those are spongy, right? The spongy lungs can accommodate change or a variation in one chamber's blood flow or one chamber dilatation. And the pericardium is flexible. In the fetus, both the pericardium is not as flexible and the lungs are solid. The fetus probably heart behaves like what? Constrictive pericarditis. The entire lung is solid. Okay, there is no space to grow. So it behaves like a constrictive, chronic constrictive pericarditis. Any small addition of the blood in either side of the chamber, right or left, would increase diastolic pressures. Abnormality of one vessel, one chamber, right ventricle or a left ventricle, would geopoietize the adjacent or a neighboring chamber as well. So there are very rare situations where I can say confidently only one ventricle is involved. If one ventricle is involved, the other ventricle gets involved by shear. This is in the closed space. We published a very rare case of absent cusp of aortic valve. This is a non-coronary cusp which was absent. Pulmonary valve was normal. And what we had in this patient was a torrential aortic regurgitation. This is systole where the blood is going away from the aorta. And this is the to and fro blood. The same blood comes back into the LV through a severe aortic regurgitation. Okay, and then what you see on this is dilated aorta. And you see the LV. LV is looking pathetic, but RV also is not good. So how come RV got involved? Just as a bystander, because it was the same cage of solid lung. If you carefully look at the LV and RV contractility, this is in a normal fetus, that they contract almost simultaneously. RV contracts, the LV contracts. In this patient, you notice the RV contraction is fine. Interventricular support is fine. The left ventricle contraction is fine, but they are not happening in the same phase. Okay, so they are out of phase. When RV and IV interventricular septum contract, so that is the time the RV is dilating. So this peculiar phenomena, because of the ventricular interdependence, produces a lot of abnormality in both the ventricles, even if the single ventricle is actually involved by any pathology. Can we diagnose tamponade? Because that's important. If there is a tamponade in the fetus, now the problem is you are already in a situation where the kind of constrictive pericarditis situation, solid lungs, and second, the baby is not taking breathing. So if there is no breathing, all those signs what we used to use for tamponade are actually gone. So what are we dependent upon in tamponade in this group is a swinging motion of the heart. What we see, this does indicate cardiac tamponade. We did have one patient which we presented again that ISOG meeting, I think in Rome. And this was the mass here. There's another mass here, a very large pericardial effusion and swinging motion, which indicated, look at the swinging motion of LV, the way I have depicted LV as a label, it's moving in and out because the LV is moving. And this is a large, thick, this thing. We would have seen this kind of situation in adult cardiology in infective pericardial effusions. Like we have seen, I've seen a couple of tubercular patients with this kind of pericardial effusion and exudates. So I thought this is something infective. So we terminated the pregnancy. And after termination of the pregnancy, the child, and we did a pericardiocentesis, and to our surprise, we found only blood. It was a hemorrhagic fluid, about 70 cc. 70 cc for this size is good enough to produce tamponade. And echo, this was after 2 days, was absolutely normal. So this was a spontaneous hemopericardium, which we reported in that fetus. In the fetus, you have a couple of different structures. We have ductus venosus, fossa vallis, ductus arteriosus. Okay, so then I'm going to present an interesting data to you. Ductus arteriosus, as you know, is critically important. This ductus arteriosus shunts the right heart blood into the descending aorta. Imagine if ductus arterios is not there or narrow, you know, where would the RV flow go? No, RV would have and would go into failure in case there is a ductal restriction. And this ductus patensi is maintained by prostaglandins, by so many other factors. The prostaglandins are generally generated from placenta. When the child is born, the placenta is out. Then the placenta is out, the quantity of prostaglandins reduce, and whatever prostaglandins are generated in the body are destroyed very quickly by the lungs. Okay, so suddenly there's a plenty of prostaglandins in the fetus which are keeping the ductus open, and at all that supply is gone and degradation is remarkably increased by the open lungs now. So that's why the ductus closes, and ductus supposed to close. But in case there are certain things which inhibit prostaglandins, could cause ductal restriction, right-sided failure, and even high drops. What are the things which can do it? We all know NSAIDs can do it, but this I'm going to tell you something new. We had a patient, a dental doctor, who was applying this stretchnil cream on the abdomen just to avoid, and the area obviously was large, and she was applying it for a couple of weeks now. And this the fetus developed ductal restriction. And we recognize this component of this ductal is having an anti-inflammatory and a prostaglandin inhibition properties, that is Rubia cardiofolia, this plant, okay? And this was producing ductal restriction. This might surprise you, plenty of polyphenols, which are, you know, food-rich sources, colored fruits, which are a rich source of polyphenols, can interfere with prostaglandins and produce ductal restriction, includes dark chocolate. I've seen one patient, grape wine, in case you have a red wine, and so many other things can do. So now next important structure is ductus venosus. Guys, it's about an hour I've taken, but you know, I hope I'm not bothering you. If this is interesting, I would continue at a slow pace. I think I'm adding a lot of information, this which would be useful and handy to you. Now, the next important structure is ductus venosus. To cover entire fetal cardiology or fetal echo in a day would be a challenge, but I think I would give you salient features in at this time. Ductus venosus, I told you, shunts the blood from the umbilical vein into the left heart. One is that this is a pure blood. This is oxygenated blood, which is being shunted. This is oxygenated in the placenta, being shunted venous from the ductus venosus and going into the right, and right from there to the left heart. Secondly, now this ductus venosus, let us presume that ductus venosus is not there. Umbilical vein, ductus venosus is a narrow channel. It reduces the pressure which is coming from the umbilical vein. So it's a pressure gauge as well. So now if the ductus is not there, that channel is not there, if umbilical vein is opening elsewhere with absent of ductus venosus, the pressures in the inferior vena cava would rise. And the entire blood would now go into the right atrium rather than going into the left atrium, because this narrow ductus venosus, which was producing a jet, which was going into the left atrium selectively, that path is gone. The entire blood now from umbilical vein enters into the right, and ductus venosus absence is not a very rare situation. Now, this is a situation where ductus venosus was absent, and we could see the blood going directly into the right atrium. And this is where the ductus venosus was absent, and that's the umbilical vein going anteriorly to the liver and entering right into the right atrium, bypassing the liver and without having a ductus venosus. And that is a glass body flow. You have a umbilical vein which is should have gone like this into the liver, and the atrium is going from the anteriorly, opening right into the right atrium, and this is the inferior vena cava. So this structure itself can produce problems. it can open anywhere, the ductus venosus. It can open into the inferior vena cava. It can open directly into the RA. It can open into the IVC. And what it produces volume overload. You would see right atrium. I missed one patient when I was in the learning curve. I only reported RA and RV dilated because I didn't have enough information how to see the ductus venosus. So ductus venosus would produce a lot of problem in case they're absent. Peculiar situation, if I knew this situation, and I tell you this is an adult echo, everyone would jump on the diagnosis of this is an LV aneurysm, sir, and this is most likely because of an LAD disease. This is an anterior wall infarction, and this is what it is doing it. In fetus, it doesn't look like this. I again presented this data, and there is a very interesting paper. What they did, guys did, was they occluded LAD in the sheep's feti, and they produced a myocardial infarction. Then they did an echo 4 weeks after that myocardial infarction. There was no sign. There was no sign of damage whatsoever. So in adult, the regeneration is not there. In the fetus, because you have regenerating, a lot of research is going on this area, which can be applied in adult cardiology and infarction areas, but it regenerates with no inflammation. The pathologies are different. In adult, you have a macrophages and you have the fibroblasts coming in. But it just regenerates from those regenerating cells or stem cells in the heart, and you have no sign. So that means that infarction was not the cause of the ventricular aneurysm. We know there are other causes which possibly can be the reason for aneurysm. We see tumors very frequently in the fetus, very large tumor. And it tells you that about 90% of the tumors, what you see, even if you say this is a rhabdomyoma, you are going to be right in 90% times. You see a tumor, you say right rhabdomyoma, then almost you are sure. The problem is not with rhabdomyoma. Problem is rhabdomyomas, they resolve of their own when the child is born. With the passage of time, the problem is that they are associated with the tuberous sclerosis complex. And the problem is they generally land up with intractable epilepsy because there are tumors in the brain as well. That's the problem. And just a couple of patients of rhabdomyoma of sizes, and that's rhabdomyoma single. This is a different shape of rhabdomyoma on the right side. And then you can have multiple rhabdomyomas. So whenever you see this kind of thing, you know this is a rhabdomyoma because 90% chance that you are correct. And then there could be very, very large and all are rhabdomyomas, and they can produce some obstructive features also. Quick wrap up is that don't ignore mild aortic stenosis or severe aortic stenosis, because that can eventually become a hypoplastic LV. How? Because there is an obstruction on the left side. So once you have an obstruction on the left side, the blood preferentially goes to the right side. The entire circulation is then maintained by the right heart more than the left heart. So blood doesn't need to go to the right left heart. So and if the blood doesn't go need to go to the right side, then gradually the left heart does not grow. If the left heart does not grow, it would produce hypoplastic or simple aortic stenosis can be a problem. So we need to follow up these patients. So aortic stenosis can go to hypoplastic left heart. TOF can lead into pulmonary atresia and becomes ductal dependent. The VSDs can close. Tricuspid regurgitation also. Important issues of cardiomegaly. If you have cardiomegaly in the fetus, whether this is because of the Epstein anomaly or this is because of tricuspid dysplasia, where the tricuspid valve is not displaced, is just thickened, it produces produces pulmonary hypoplasia because the lung, the chest cage, it is Now, arrhythmias, you have a luxury of ECG in the diagnosis of arrhythmia. But in the fetus, see, we have to use indirect signs. Now, E wave represents this, and obviously A wave represents the P wave, and QRST segment is represented by the V wave. Okay. And what we do is that we take LV inflow and outflow with a large sample volume, and we take both LV outflow and inflow. Based on that, we make an assessment of arrhythmia. You can do it with an M mode where you put a cursor line with one ventricle and one atrium. You see the atrial and ventricle activities. Based on that, you make an assessment of, and this is a second degree AV block with the 4:3 AV conduction. You see the fourth beat is not conducted. So the M mode can help you in making the diagnosis. This is something important in patients, those who had SLE or those who have anti-RO and anti-LA antibodies. The heart block goes through phases, phase one and phase two, first and second degree heart block. If you use steroid, you can prevent third degree heart block. But in case third degree heart block develops, you can't do anything. So we are doing regular screening of high-risk patients, those who can develop heart block by PR interval. We call it mechanical PR interval. It is beginning of E wave to a beginning of a ventricular ejection time. Then from here, this is called a mechanical PR. And if the PR is more than 150, it's abnormal. When more than 160 is pathognomic of prolonged PR interval, that is one of the patients where the PR interval was prolonged. For ectopics, we don't have ECG, but we use, if the atrial activity comes first, then the ventricle one with a pause, this is atrial. If the ventricle activity comes and there is no preceded atrial activity, we presume this is a ventricular ectopic. Ventricular ectopics are exceedingly rare. 99% ectopics are atrial. We can actually diagnose a QT interval based on isovolemic relaxation time. This is a recent article, and hope this is a game changer in making a diagnosis along QT syndromes. And thank you very much for your attention. I took more than an hour of yours. We did publish this thing in our Indian Journal of Indian Academy of Echocardiography, and this is free. You can go and download it, and what can use as a ready reference in for the future. And please apply this knowledge, what you've acquired, because the wisdom is in application, not in acquiring knowledge. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. It was indeed a very informative and an interesting session. I think people wanted you to continue for as long as possible, and I think this is the biggest compliment. Now we are open to take questions if there are any. You can type in the chat window. And
I think that the previous messages were all good mornings, and somebody typed that can't get an Audi. I wish you get, because I hope he meant audio. Anyway, so where are we? Where? Now the first question is from Rajewade, that is, if there is a preductal coarctation, will there be LVH? If not, why? See, let's say if a situation is that there is a preductal coarctation, now in this the blood flows preferentially to the right side. How the blood does that? Because you have a fossa valles. Now the blood, rather than coming from right to left, the quantum of blood coming from right to left through fossa valles reduces remarkably. Normally it's 80%. Let me make a rough guess. It reduces to half, about 40%. LV becomes small because now it's not getting blood. And when the LV becomes small, the aorta becomes smaller still, then it depends upon what is the degree of the stenosis and the preductal, we can actually get into a hypoplastic left heart kind of system, because hypertrophy doesn't happen. The LV does not push itself against the gradient. It just let's say, for example, there is a coarctation, or I give you an example of interruption of aortic arch. Okay, that I think would be a clearer, a better example. So if you have an interruption of aortic arch, now what happens there, that there is an interruption between the commonest one is between left subclavian and between the left common carotid. So now in this situation, the LV is pumping blood into the brachiocephalic nominate and to the left carotid artery, and the left subclavian is being supplied by the ductus through the pulmonary artery. So the load is being taken by the right ventricle. So it is the right ventricle actually which suffers in any interruption. The LV would supply the area where it is supplying, and the area where there is a coarctation becomes a watershed area. There's no flow there. The distal area of the arch is taken care by the right ventricle. So no hypertrophy, LV only becomes small. So can we have a discussion on arrhythmia? Sure. I recently had a series of three webinars with Mediscan, and three were tachyarrhythmia, each of about half an hour lectures. Go to site Mediscan of Chennai, and you find out a contact person. Maybe you can request them that they can send you an email for regular webinars, and they do keep our recorded webinars also. There is a suggestion from Dr. Kulkarni that we need to have an adult valvular. I am in touch with the very senior faculty, which includes Dr. J. Simon, Dr. Vinayak, Dr. Gobind, Dr. Kasliwal, and they are willing to participate in this forum, and we would give them a valvular heart disease. Maybe I'll request Dr. Nitin Burkle to deliver a talk on aortic stenosis to begin with, and I would pass on that request, and maybe we would do it. The journal name is our own Indian Journal of Academy of Echocardiography, Journal of Indian Academy of Echocardiography and Vascular Diseases is the journal, and you can go that. This is a free access. Application of strain imaging, I expected that because I could not show it. We had a tough time standardizing strain imaging in the adult echo. So if I apply the strain in fetal echo, we don't have standardization of both equipments and the vendors. So I think it would be a little difficult, premature to say strain. There are a lot of people doing strain imaging. I also have done plenty, but I have not put to a clinical use as yet. I'm not really sure, but I think that there would be a future there. So how do we diagnose TA-PVC on fetal echo? I told you there are indirect signs, and there are direct signs. Now with the advancement in equipments, we have seen almost all types of TA-PVC, TA-PVC which is supracardiac, and TA-PVC opening into the coronary sinus, and pulmonary veins directly opening into RA in an intracardiac TA-PVC, and infracardiac TA-PVC, which is quite common. TA-PVC incidentally is very common with the isomerisms. So we've seen plenty of TA-PVCs, and when the opportunity comes, maybe I'll share with you that. Dedicated electric feature, I already answered. does DV, abnormal DV results in hemodynamic changes? And of course, there are two kinds of, you know, broadly, of absent DV. One is an absent DV when the umbilical vein drains into the portal sinus directly. So doesn't really affect hemodynamics much in this situation. But if it is opening directly into RA, the major problem, if it opens into the pulmonary, into the liver sinusoids, the pressure drops. If it opens directly into the IVC, the high pressure of umbilical vein transmitted to IVC and then to RA, that creates more problems. Okay. So the where we have absent DV and it is opening elsewhere, another compounding factor is an absent of pulmonary hepatic, that the portal system. If the portal system is partially or completely absent, that creates a big problem, not in the fetus, in the neonate period also, because the liver is compromised. How do we differentiate dilated RA RV in third trimester due to ductal restriction and coarctation, direct amendment of vessels or gradients? For a coarctation, a gradient. Because when you see for ductal restriction, it's gradient. Ductal restriction because from the right ventricle, when it is ejecting, the blood has nowhere else to go. It can either go through TR into the right ventricle, but it has to go through the ductus because it can't go to the pulmonary artery into the lungs because they are all solid. Go through the force and produces a gradient across the ductus. The diagnosis of ductus restriction is by gradient. And for a coarctation of aorta, we can have direct myosmosis. Fortunately, RA and LA, RA and RV are dilated normally, slightly larger than the counterparts. If the RA and RV dilatation is more than 1.6 times the counterparts, then we take it seriously. The next webinar, we would very shortly announce the way you got the information of this webinar. If aorta is not seen, that is by Dr. Gaurav Sharma, if aorta is not seen in three vessel view in HLHS with dilated PA, then how to differentiate truncus from a critical aortic stenosis? That's a challenge. There are differential diagnosis of single vessel, large vessel in a three vessel view, whether it's aorta or pulmonary artery, and if you're not seeing the other artery, it becomes very, very difficult. For aorta, I don't think so, it's a great difficulty. You do see a retrograde flow. You have to see a retrograde flow in case you have to reduce your Nyquist limit. In an HLHS situation, you would see an aorta for sure or a retrograde flow for sure because something has to supply coronary arteries. The ascending aorta is the way which supplies the coronary arteries. Just to supply the coronary arteries, the retrograde flow in the aorta is maintained. So that means just supplying coronary artery, the ascending aorta doesn't have much demand. It's not very big. So generally the retrograde flow in the aorta is very small. You have to look for it. It is always there. For a pulmonary, this thing, if you don't see the pulmonary artery, then situation is different. Then it could be truncus or it could be pulmonary atresia with collaterals coming from the descending aorta. Aorta you always see. Partially anomalous PAVC, how to diagnose? It's difficult to diagnose all four pulmonary veins entering into, but we don't work our head into it because it's not very, very important, except for a Schmittar syndrome where the right lower pulmonary vein opens into the inferior vena cava or hepatic veins. In that situation, the right lung lower base is slightly hypoventilated and it develops less and there is a shift of the heart towards the right side. Apart from that, PAPVC is not very, very important. Heterotaxis, again, is a complex. I presume we can go through the literature because I couldn't discuss everything in such a short period. Heterotaxy is that we don't call it heterotaxy. There is a lot of issues about nomenclatures. which heterotaxy is anything away from the normal. So therefore that situation, situs solitus and situs inversus, in fact the situs inversus also would become heterotaxy. Heterotaxy is away from normal, right? Normal texture. So so there are called, we call it isomerism, and entire body isomerism is not there. It is isomerism of the atria. So we call it right isomerism and a left isomerism. So in the neonatal echo, if we have PDA, can we CW wave criteria? A very, very tricky, a very nice question. I think next time we would have a pediatric cardiologist to present something on this forum. You can miss coarctation in of aorta in case you have a PDA. The blood from PDA actually flows. When the PDA closes, it actually pulls down the ledge of the coarctation, and coarctation suddenly appears, and you don't see a coarctation before that. So coarctation in this situation, generally symptoms appear on the third day. A lot of people miss coarctation in situation of a PDA. Which type of RAA associated with increased risk of 22q11? Right sided aortic arch is marginally increased risk of microdeletion or DeGeorge's syndrome. And in case you find right sided aortic arch with the size of the hypo the thymus being smaller, or the highest incidence of DeGeorge's syndrome or microdeletion is an interruption of aortic arch. Short of that, the next common is a DORV, and probably right-sided aortic arch would be the last, and the incidence is very small. Dr. Saji suggesting, hi Dr. Saji, suggesting that some basic gradient level to suspect ductal ductus arteriosus, like more than by or I presume that you are hinting at ductal restriction. We have a normogram available. For example, in about 24-25 weeks, if we get a ductal restriction, the velocity is more than 140 centimeter, and a diastolic velocity of more than 40 would be characteristic of ductal restriction. But as you move with the pregnancy, the velocities across the ductus, has the highest velocity anyway in the fetus circulation. So the velocities increase. So we can have velocities up to 180 centimeter per second in a ductus in an advanced gestation. That is where generally the ductal restriction happens. If it crosses 2 meters, it's diagnostic. But there is a normogram available, we can follow that. Dr. Kulkarni, dextro position, dextrocardia, dextro, will you please explain? Simple. I don't think so, it's simple. There's a lot of issues with the nomenclature. Maybe we will take that sometime later, because it's whenever I get an opportunity, I'll present you data with the slides. By just saying otherwise may not be as understandable. Some way, same way, isthmus gradient when narrowing time a bit difficult to assess fossa fixation. Yeah, there are a couple of areas, Dr. Raji, I agree with you. There are a couple of areas where we can use a gradient as that's probably what you wanting to hint at, where we can use gradient as a diagnostic method. One is a restriction of a fossa ovalis. Absolutely, there the gradient is the main thing, and then second is a ductal restriction. Again, gradient is the most important parameter. Dr. Saji, again, lungs are solid. We see large, hardly no lung tissue. How to evaluate hypoplastic lung? Now, there are criterias to diagnose hypoplastic lung. Basically what we use is the ratio of abdominal circumference with the chest circumference, and there are ways of calculating volumes. I'm not very comfortable and do not know more about them. There are ways of knowing hypoplastic lung, because this is something very, very important, because if there is a cardiomegaly, it would produce, it will jeopardize lung's growth. Second main area is when you have a renal agenesis, you have a reduced Liker. Liker swelling is very, very important for growth of the lungs. So if you have a renal agenesis, the Liker is less, baby swallows less amount of amnion. So then also it reduces the there is pulmonary hypoplasia. How to measure QT interval and fetal echo? This was a recent article. Prior to that, we didn't know anything about it. What we do is that you measure LV, IV, RT, isovolemic relaxation time, and see how much time is it to the cardiac cycle. What percentage? Is it 30% or 20% or 10% of the cardiac cycle? Then you can actually decide whether QT is prolonged. So more than 13, that is more than if the 13% of the cardiac cycle is IVRT, this is highly suggestive of a prolonged QT interval. For optimizing M-mode and 2D, we would have a separate discussion. This was a general thought-provoking talk. I wanted to share my journey from there, and mainly I wanted all the adult cardiologists that learn swimming even if you are in shallow waters. So you need to know hemodynamics, you need to know how it's abnormal. It very frequently happens, and it did happen with me, that a gynecologist my wife radiologist would ask me, you're a cardiologist, tell me what is happening with the heart. And I would make a random guess and tell something which may not be correct. The reason being, I did not know about, say, two decades back what hemodynamic happened in the fetus. Come out in the fourth chamber, no defect in LVOT, RVT. Does it rule out? Yes, it rules out VST with a very limited sensitivity and specificity. This picking up a VSD is critically, it's difficult. It's a very, very common every now and then. After about 4 or 5 months, we get one patient where they say that the VST was there, but you didn't pick up in fetal echo, but it does happen. Is there any difference between IVS is viewed from the fetus left lateral and right lateral? No, the lateral is lateral, whether it's right or left doesn't really make a difference. For an assessment of interventricular septum, we suggest all the views should be there, the apical four chamber view or a basal four chamber view, and the lateral view. And the best one would be oblique, okay, where it's about 45 degrees. I think I should thank you all for being such a patient listener and making it such an interactive session. And the entire credit goes to Philip's team, Indresh and Ranjit, for making it successful.